Good morning, everyone, and welcome to this morning's National Organization for Fetal Alcohol Spectrum Disorders webinar. If you require technical assistance, please phone Redback Support on 1-800-733-416. If you wish to listen to this presentation via the phone, the dial-in number and passcode is listed in the chat box. This webinar is being recorded, and you will be sent a copy of the recording early when it becomes available. If you would like to ask a question during today's presentation, please do so using the chat box, which is located on the left-hand side of your screen. I'll now hand you over to Anne Heath to begin.
Hi, everybody. So we'll get started, and I'd like to welcome everyone to attendance at the September FASD seminar for International FASD Awareness Day. Today's dedicated to raising opportunities to reflect on and consider the choices we have with alcohol-free pregnancy and to share in this prevention message across the world. So beyond this webinar, if you have a moment today, please have a look at our webpage to see what's happening around the world and how you can share this message. And if you're on social media sites, be sure to use the hashtag FASD Awareness Day. If we can get this hashtag to trend just a little bit, we'll know we're spreading such an important message. And as always, it's wonderful to see so many people from across the country joining into this presentation or registering to see it, to watch it later on down the track. And technology is so wonderful because we can connect from so many remote places. Again, I'm on the beautiful northwest coast of Tasmania, a bit rainy today, but hopefully you won't hear too many of my roosters in the background. And I'd like to ask you, if you have any questions, please write them down and I'll answer as many of them as I can at the end. So a little about who FASD is. We were established in 1999 to represent the interests of people and families living with FASD in Australia. So we're the essential bridge between researchers, clinicians and those with lived experience. We're now the national peak body working towards influencing policymakers and medical professionals for the rights of individuals with FASD and the rights of their families. Our vision is the prevention of alcohol-exposed pregnancies in Australia and an improved quality of life for those living with FASD. And this is the work that NOFASD Australia delivers. We have support services, both online and telephone inquiries, and advocacy through consultation. We have community engagement, which is applying a community development approach because communities are unique and diverse, and this is where change will always happen. We try to influence policy and advocacy because we represent the interests of those living with recognised and unrecognised FASD. We provide education and training to the service provider sector because this is where the most need is, and unfortunately some of the bigger barriers to understanding FASD as a brain-based condition. We develop partnerships because we have 2.3 equivalent staff, which means that FASD Australia cannot meet the demand, and because we're positioned in the FASD problem system in Australia. And we do research because we must ensure that research should inform and improve the lives of those who live and are affected by the problem, and those whose lives will be affected. So this presentation will meet a number of objectives. By the end of the session, you should have a knowledge of what FASD is, how it affects the individual, the learning challenges that are faced by children growing up with FASD, the best way you can respond as a parent or a carer to an individual with or a child with FASD, and how you can support them, because responding to and offering support can sometimes be quite different and result in different outcomes. And finally, it's self-care for you as a person who is responsible for someone who is living with FASD. So, what's fetal alcohol spectrum disorder and what causes it? Let's have a look. So there's a number of conditions that can be caused by the developing fetus being exposed to alcohol. These can be both physical and neurodevelopmental, and FASD is the term we use to cover all of these possibilities. FASD is now one of the most serious harms caused by alcohol from the time the child is conceived right through to death. FASD can be prevented, but at the moment in Australia, it's one of the leading preventable causes of non-genetic disability. There are more FASD sufferers born each year than all sufferers of autism, spina bifida, cerebral palsy, Downs, and sudden infant death syndrome. And because it's so prevalent in Australia, it's a very serious public health issue. FASD does not discriminate in any way, so any woman who drinks alcohol during pregnancy at any time can put their unborn child at risk. And FASD can be difficult for practitioners to distinguish from other developmental disorders since they share similar learning and behavioural problems. As a result, FASD is often misdiagnosed, so the treatments and recommended strategies don't work effectively. In the diagnosis process, it's important to try to find a practitioner who is knowledgeable about FASD, so that the correct diagnosis can be made. And NOFASD can assist you to find those practitioners if you don't already know who they are. Alcohol causes changes in the way the brain develops, which cannot be reversed. And often you'll hear how some organs can fix themselves at the time of removal of the toxin. For example, we hear often that as soon as you stop smoking, the body will start to repair itself. This is not the case with brain development because the damage has been done at the time the brain is forming. And at this stage, there is no evidence to indicate that the effects of prenatal alcohol exposure can be cured. So an adult healthy liver can metabolise only about one standard drink in an hour. So for an unformed or an unhealthy liver, it can take much longer for the body to free itself of alcohol. So the alcohol needs to go somewhere else. And this slide shows the risk of the developing fetus across gestation. The dark green denotes the sensitivity period or the most sensitive period where the central nervous system is developing. So you can only guess what may happen when alcohol is consumed prior to confirmation of pregnancy, which may not be up until the fifth or sixth week of pregnancy. In that time, the brain and the central nervous system has started to develop, the skeletal and major organs have started to develop, the ears, eyes, teeth and genitalia are all developing, and they may already be damaged if alcohol is consumed. And right up until the fetus is born and the baby is born, alcohol can still cause problems. Damage can occur at various regions of the brain, and the area that might be affected depends on which area is developing at the time the alcohol is consumed. Here you can see the difference between the developing brain without alcohol and another brain that has been subject to alcohol. This is a 6-week baby brain and there's quite a lot of difference. Not all brain damage is seen on brain scans, as lesions might be too small to be detected, but they can be large enough to cause significant disabilities. And this is an extreme example of what may be seen on scans where prenatal exposure has been significant. The safest way to avoid FASD is to simply not drink alcohol when you are planning a pregnancy, during pregnancy, and also when breastfeeding. And unfortunately, the first thing a mother does when they find that their child may have FASD is to blame themselves. But we know that no mother intentionally tries to harm their unborn child. And one of the worst things we can do is judge a mother on her child if it has FASD. FASD is the result of a lack of knowledge around drinking while pregnant. And if you're not planning to become pregnant, you may well be drinking in that vital time when the central nervous system is developing. So if you have enjoy a drink and you've not heard of FASD, you're surprised that you're pregnant, then the chances can be increased. So we need to get that awareness out there. So we'll now look at what the medical diagnosis looks like. The guidelines are currently being updated, so some of this terminology is changing a little. But ultimately, it's the same. On the spectrum of FASD, FAS is the full syndrome. FAS can be caused when alcohol is consumed by the mother on the 17th to the 20th day of pregnancy. And there are visible differences in the face of the person with FAS. There are also often physical abnormalities associated with FASD, and these can affect school performance and achievement when a child starts school. For example, poor vision and hearing loss associated with malformed ears and eyes. And there are multiple possible abnormalities. And in FASD, these can mostly be identified in the facial features, which we'll have a look at now. In this picture, you can see that the child has small eyes and they have a smooth philtrum, which is the area between the nose and the upper lip. And they also have a thin upper lip. You can also see in this picture that FASD children also have a flat midface, which is across the cheeks and nose area. A small head circumference, which is the measurement around the head. The ears are lower on each side than usual, so low set ears. Sometimes you'll see a small chin. And sometimes the fingers and or hands may have some malformation as well. And this example outlines more details about the eye. A FASD child will have a smaller than average distance between point A and point B. And it's also likely to be a flap between the nose and corner of the eye, which is visible in this picture, which is just here. You can also see a scale of lips on the right-hand side that is similar to the ones used in diagnosis, where one is no presence of FASD and five indicates a definite presence. On the spectrum of FASD, there are also two other diagnoses that are not as obvious as FASD, but they are just as severe. These are partial fetal alcohol syndrome that has some of the physical signs of FASD, but not all of them, and neurodevelopmental disorder, alcohol exposed, where there's no physical signs, but there has been prenatal exposure to alcohol. All diagnoses of FASD include impairment in the central nervous system. So those that have NDAE are at the highest risk of misdiagnosis because they don't have the physical features. And quite often this is put down to the child's behaviour rather than a disability, which is why so often FASD is called the invisible disability. But unfortunately, there's absolutely no difference to how severe the dysfunction in the brain is. These diagnoses have different criteria, but all are the same in that there is some kind of brain damage. What that damage looks like will be different from child to child or person to person. And each one will have different challenges in daily living, learning, and how they behave. So what are the signs that a child or an individual you're working with or caring for may be living with FASD? And these can be cognitive, emotional, interpersonal, medical or neuromotor, speech or language, impulsivity or dismaturity. And we'll have a look at some of these now too. The cognitive characteristics of a child with FASD include problems with math, and their memory will be poor, especially trying to move things into their long-term memory. Now, they may remember a task for a couple of days and then quite likely forget it. And their spatial orientation will also be affected. So being able to change their location in a room or a space in relation to objects they can see, they're unsteady on their feet. And little awareness of themselves or ability to think about what they're doing. Children with FASD will also have an intense emotion or intense emotions overall with a sense of urgency. So they'll struggle to explain how they're feeling, especially if they don't recognise the emotion. So they're prone to mood disorders and potential rage. And there are many interpersonal challenges. Children with FASD will probably not understand social cues like personal space. They won't be able to consider how others are feeling, and they may not bond with others. Children with FASD have difficulties understanding truth from fiction, and they will not accept blame. And they'll always demand a great deal of attention. An impulsive, coupled with inability to judge consequences and to predict outcomes, and so the individual will act first. There will be a number of medical and neuromotor concerns, and some of these will include poor balance and coordination. They may struggle with sleeping or eating. They're likely to suffer ear infections or allergies and asthma. They may have heart and kidney problems, prone to seizures, and be very hyperactive. With speech and language, individuals with FASD will appear to be fluent, but it's mostly superficial. They'll be able to talk non-stop, but it won't be very meaningful. They will be able to copy the patterns of other people's speech, and their language can be very expressive. And they'll agree often, but they'll not fully comprehend what they're agreeing to. The actual number of words that they can use creates the impression that they're able to understand, but this is not always the case. Children and individuals living with FASD often overreact to stimuli. Tactile defensiveness, so tactiles, textures, smells, tastes, lighting and noise. They'll be overwhelmed by sensory input because they're unable to filter out unnecessary stimuli. Increased agitation, irritability and aggression. And they may underreact to pain, so not complain about aches or broken bones, heat or cold. And some children and individuals with FASD will have a low IQ, but the majority of people living with FASD will have a normal IQ. And they'll be expected to behave in the same way as other people of the same age and maturity. But unfortunately, they'll lack the capacity to use their IQ making expectations. So all of these expectations can be over-expected. This maturity often functions socially and emotionally and mentally at a younger age. So a younger level than their chronological age. So someone who's 15 may be more developmentally a 9-year-old. And they may be rigid and stuck on an idea or a thought, which is perseveration. They may have problems switching thoughts, stopping activities or transforming to a new task. And they often react strongly to changes in settings, programs, or people. And when all this becomes too much and the child has a meltdown, they will most likely be punished by the teacher or the caregiver, depending on the situation. But again, the child will also be unlikely to respond to traditional punishment methods. So in a sense, they're actually getting punished for not being able to understand. And we need to remember that this disruptive behaviour is not that of a child that's naughty, but one that's unable to process. The list goes on as well. Problems with social behaviours will also be apparent. They'll be unable to follow multiple directions or rules. They'll have difficulty with abstract reasoning and not able to understand cause and effect, and difficulty organising tasks and materials. And due to the auditory processing problems, children or individuals may not be able to respond to traditional teaching methods either at home or at school. They may struggle particularly with math, and they may fidget or become frustrated. And if they don't know what's going on, or they're being punished for something that's happened, or being punished because they have a meltdown, we need to be supportive in that space. And you may be able to recognise when someone with FASD is feeling overwhelmed. So if you see this type of meltdown coming on, some best strategies that you can use are to be sure that the child is safe and other people are safe and get them to a calm space. Slow down if you're talking or doing something too quickly, and don't use too many words. So back right off, and sometimes you may feel like that you can walk away and let the child self calm. Don't shout or use no's and don'ts. Try to find a yes. And this is one of the best ways that you can love and support them until you can actually get to a point where you can talk it out. So when something doesn't seem to work, stop and have a look at what's going on. And ask the child, ask them what would help them calm down. Sometimes even some music will work, some light music if you're at home. Maybe they need some rest time. Maybe they need some more information to complete a task. They're trying to make the right choices. So offer encouragement when they are able to make the right choice. As I said earlier on, each child will be different depending on the area of the brain that's been damaged. There is not a one-size-fits-all approach when working with or caring for FASD children. We need to always remember it's more likely that they can't do something, not that they won't. And remembering this takes a lot of practice, because for us, it's doing something differently as well. It takes a small army of brain experts, multidisciplinary teams, to cobble together a diagnosis using a lot of standardised tests and professional judgment. So this is how the diagnosis process works. The first step is referral to a medical expert who is knowledgeable with FASD. And the National Organisation of Fetal Alcohol Spectrum Disorders can help you find the right medical professional in your state. Once the appointment has been made, the doctor will need to commence their screening and they'll establish if the fetus was exposed to alcohol. A psychologist will most likely also be involved and they'll be able to provide or conduct tests at school. An occupational therapist will look at how the child copes in the world. They'll look at everything from sensory trouble to dexterity. So they'll look at whether a toddler is walking on time, if older kids can throw a ball or use scissors. They'll look at how sensitive the child is to sound. And I'll also wonder and have a look and see if the child notices if someone comes into the room and if they splash in the bathtub, for example. All of these can test the child's development. And I use a group of fun tests to check speech and language development. And these will be designed to gauge how well the child understands language, how the child expresses themselves, how they use grammar, and how they start or end a conversation. Doctors will also be involved. Pediatricians and geneticists will measure everything from the child's head size to their reflexes and muscle tones. And of course, they'll also check whether the child has any of the classic FASD facial features which we've discussed earlier. Once all of these tests are done and all of these experts hash out their findings, sometimes they disagree. But if they come to a consensus on diagnosis, they make a to-do list for all of those who are involved with the child. And follow-up includes confirmation of a diagnosis in plain language and explains what's next. And that could be to meet with the teachers at school, to organise a special education plan, or if the young person is working, to implement a work schedule. It'll be all about building supports to help daily living. So how can we help individuals who have FASD? There are a number of ways. And these include ensuring that things are appropriately modified, to ensure that the approach is concrete and consistent, and that we persist with it and include repetition. We keep to a routine and make it simple and specific. And these tips not just help children and individuals with FASD, it can be a great outcome for everybody. And the best way we can help individuals and children with FASD is through early intervention with that multidisciplinary team. The earlier the diagnosis can be made, the better quality of life. And regular meetings and talking with this team can make a huge difference. So helping babies, there's some simple things we can do to make a world of difference in their early development, whether we're aware there's potential FASD or not. So cuddling and massage, warm bath, wrapping in a warm blanket or a sleeping bag and listening to some soft music, and keep the lighting low, keeping things a little plain, so not a lot of bright colours or mobiles hanging from their cot or their high chair. And helping children. A good way is observation, so looking at a logbook or use a logbook to identify triggers, things that you may notice leading up to the events of when a child may have a meltdown. So things like bright lights or excessive noise can be in the logbook, and they could be at certain times of the day. Changes in environments and routines. And changes in expectations, so even a different babysitter will have different expectations. So being able to observe that and make a note can make a world of difference. FASD children tend to take longer to develop the neural pathways to master tasks and commit them to memory. So we need to be able to repeat what we're saying regularly or what we're doing, so it becomes part of everyday communication style. And keeping it a regular routine and time schedule and prompts which convey information. So use some pictures or visual cues. And concrete language is very important, so avoiding innuendo or implied language. Be straight to the point. Be concrete in your language, so one instruction at a time. And if you can, show them what you need, so demonstrate the behaviour. And reward systems, as I said earlier, children are trying to do the right thing. So praise and reward them immediately after positive behaviour or successful achievements. And supervision. It's essential to closely monitor people to account for developmental age, which is much less than their chronological age. And there are benefits from seeing and practicing appropriate behaviours. So model the behaviours that you want to see. So the basic strategies are think younger. Always remember that the child will be developmentally younger than their chronological age. Be direct, say what you mean. Slow down your speech and use less words. Use visual support like hand signs, drawings, photographs. Don't give too many options. And repeat yourself and remind on a regular basis. Now, focused a little bit more on routine, because routine is one of the most important things we can do to help those living with FASD. Why? Because it aims to build independence and life skills. So plan for change if you can, because change creates an overwhelming confusion for those living with FASD. They function way better in well-structured and consistent environments. They have a hard time learning and remembering new things and understanding actions and consequences and making the switch from one thing to another. So think about how these impacts can be minimised. And again, with routines, keep your instructions short, as I mentioned. And when you repeat, be prepared to repeat over and over and over, because children with FASD have such difficulty moving information from short-term to long-term memory. Things need to be repeated. Take things that you're teaching, lessons, into other settings. So if you've been able to teach your child something at home, try and move that into another setting as well, like at a friend's place, so that they know that what they learn in one place can also be transferred. Never fear to be a little bit creative. Always have a backup plan, and as always, be as consistent as you can yourself and other people. And a few things on managing behaviour. Accommodate the behaviour rather than trying to change the child, particularly with things like temper tantrums and hyperactivity, and difficulty with paying attention. So if you can change the environment, it's a lot easier than trying to change the child. Things that you may be able to change, address those as quick as you can. And as I mentioned earlier, there's not a one-size-fits-all approach, so experiment with different strategies until you get something that works. And even when you do, that may not work all of the time. A child with FASD will need a lot of sleep because they're so active during the day, so make sure that they have enough time to rest. Again, reward good behaviour. And check for hunger and thirst. If they're hungry and thirsty, that's another thing that's added to their challenges. But also give them responsibilities so that they can build on their strengths. And make sure that they have a special place where they can calm down. And keep your expectations as realistic as you can. And always remember, because a FASD child can be naive and gullible, children living with FASD can often be the scapegoat. So to develop appropriate behavioural patterns, they need to be consistently supervised so that they're not led astray or encouraged into inappropriate behaviours. Basic principles, always remember that if a child with FASD can't do something, it's not that they're naughty or they won't. So if you're realistic in what to expect, you'll be able to accommodate these social environments and the barriers. We'll have a brief look at secondary disabilities now. And quite often the primary condition of FASD, the actual brain injury, can be misdiagnosed. So those living with FASD can suffer many difficulties because of frustration or sadness of not living up to their expectations. And there's a real fear that they won't live up to their expectations of others. And this can lead to a number of associated problems, which we call secondary conditions or secondary disabilities. Without identification and appropriate support, there is often a sad trajectory of failure, loss and confusion for children living with FASD. And this can result in these multiple secondary defensive behaviours that can lead to involvement in the justice system and multiple mental health diagnoses. The key difference between success and failure is the presence of appropriate accommodations to assist people to live successfully in the community. So some of these secondary conditions can be things like using illegal drugs or relying on alcohol. And depression and anxiety, if you're trying to spend so much time living up to the expectations of others and not able to meet them, you can become incredibly depressed and anxious. So dropping out of school or being suspended can be quite possible, and breaking the law as well, especially when being led astray or being the scapegoat. But with the right support, the quality of life for those living with FASD can be significantly improved. And as with any disability, and as you've seen today, there are also many things we can do to ensure the quality of life is as best as possible. And similar to autism, a person living with FASD is likely to be extremely good at something, and far more than would be expected, whether it be creativity or athletics or music. And it's so vital that these strengths are recognised, nurtured and developed. Unfortunately though, these strengths can also often mask the severity of other symptoms. And to cope with the intensity of working with individuals and families or living with someone with FASD, you must acknowledge that this experience will also affect you. So be honest with yourself in that working with or living with or supporting a child with FASD will be challenging. So just remember that these can be really difficult times, and take care of yourself too. And a few ways you can do that is to remember to not take behaviours personally. Take time out and structure some time. Connect with other parents, so find someone to talk to. Don't try to be perfect. Everybody aspires to be perfect. Just don't try to go there. And if you're able to spend time with other parents and other children, you can compare ideas and things that work. Do something that's in your community, something that's about you. And often you may be able to access childcare or respite services. So, who could be a support person? You need to be able to secure a support system that works for you. And your support person or your support system could be a partner or a friend, a family member, a midwife or a counsellor, a health service or a doctor, or it could be all of those. Make sure you've got a support system that also works for you. And also remember to try and get some you time in a way that works for you as well. Not always as simple as it sounds, but just some things that may work for you. And these are a few ideas. And finally, NOFASD Australia are here to help you too. We can help you develop a plan to be able to absorb the emotion of all of it. We can listen and offer support. And we can take on some of that emotional pain. And our website is loaded with resources. And if there's still something that you can't find, we'll find it for you. So that brings us to the end of today's webinar, and I would like to thank everyone for joining us. These are our contact details if you'd like to get in contact with us, if anyone listening today or anyone you know would like to get in contact for further details about any of those supports I mentioned or future webinars or training, please feel free to get in touch. So thank you very much. We will leave it there.
Thank you, Anne, for a fantastic presentation, and thank you to everyone for participating in today's webinar. Just a reminder, you will be sent a copy of this recording early next week when the recording becomes available. Thank you for your participation. Have a lovely day.